Chapel Hill, North Carolina. Quarterfinal number four, the eighth seed in Stony Brook, taking on the number one team in the country and top seed in Carolina. Tar Heels, well, they're seeking their fourth consecutive semifinal appearance, and the Sea Wolves, well, they hope to make the semifinals for the very first time. Taking a look at brackets, and Stony Brook or Carolina will take on Northwestern, who crushed Syracuse 15-4. Maryland and Boston College, they will meet in semifinal number two, a game they last played together in 2019 to make up that national championship game. Good evening, everyone. Leah Secondo, Dana Boyle with you. And Dana, as we look at this one, Stony Brook may have this one circled on their calendar a little bit more in advance than Carolina coming into this one.
Absolutely. They've never made it to a Final Four, so for them, this means a lot. They're not afraid of North Carolina. They know they're undefeated. They know they're really talented, but this game, they had it circled for a long time. In North Carolina, they got a target on their back because Stony Brook, they're not afraid.
And the reason for that circle is the outcome last time on this very field was not a good one for the Sea Wolves. Stony Brook led 11-9 in the quarterfinals right here on this field a year ago. Under 9 minutes to go, and UNC would unleash five unanswered goals. Scotty Wars-Browney, Jamie Ortega, Katie Hogue, and this crew. Four goals for Ortega in that game, and Carolina comes back to win it 14-11. Jamie Ortega still on the field, the four-time All-American, 64 goals on the season. She leads this very potent attack.
She's incredible. Watching her play every game, she just gets better and better. But what I love most about Jamie Ortega, not only is she rewriting UNC, ACC, NCAA record books, but she's setting up her teammates to be successful. And when you have a selfless player like Jamie Ortega, that's a coach's dream, but it makes and pushes your team to be better.
Charlie Campbell will start in goal for the Sea Wolves tonight. What a great fifth year she has had coming over from Virginia. 12 saves in the victory against Rutgers.
Huge get for Stony Brook. I think Charlie Campbell brings an intensity to the defense. If she can have the similar save percentage that she had in that Rutgers game in that second round, just above 60%, she'll give her team a chance to beat North Carolina.
Recognized for the player of the week coming off of that great victory for the Sea Wolves. She's ready, we're ready. Game number four on the docket, the quarterfinals. Stony Brook and North Carolina will now take a moment of silence, raise their sticks in solidarity prior to the start of this game to express their support for the student athletes at Delaware State and Howard University in light of the recent controversial incidents that each team experienced.
I've loved watching all the teams in the tournament really take this stance and use their platform to have the conversations. We got a lot of work to do, but them using this as a moment to showcase, hey, we need to get better and we need to continue this conversation, I think really speaks to the type of leadership. And I love that the lacrosse community is discussing this.
Stony Brook in the dark jerseys, Carolina in the home whites. The winner will get Northwestern next week in the national semifinals. And the scoop up, and Carolina wins the draw. Always one of the key points for each team.
And more so, I think, in the NCAA tournament. I think it's the goal circle with the goalkeepers, but I also think the draw is so important, and I think you have to have possession off the draw. That is key. You've got to take it into your offensive end. Good possession for North Carolina here to start the game.
This has been a long day of waiting for both teams. They got out here early. Stony Brook did about 10 o'clock, went through their walkthrough before the heat really rose. And for Carolina, they came out, did a brief walk around 2:30. Everyone was just gnawing at the bit, trying to get on this field to get ready for this game tonight.
And it finally feels like spring.
Yes.
I was here 2 weeks ago and it was pouring rain, so it's hot out there. So to have that 7:30 game, I think, is a big advantage for both of these teams.
We'll see how patient Carolina is working against the Stony Brook zone.
Great knockdown there by Haley Dillon. That's why you gotta put your sticks up. always sticks have to be up, just like in basketball when you put your hands up in the paint, very similar to play defense in women's lacrosse.
We expected Carolina to kind of work the shot clock down. It is at 15 seconds. Caitlin Wurzberger now. Works from behind. And a foul called as the clock will stop.
An uncharacteristic turnover. You do not see that a lot from North Carolina.
Five seconds on the shot clock. And Hillman very fortunate to have that ball in her stick. Look at this. Great opportunity. First look for Charlie Campbell. Elizabeth Hillman with the ball. Rips it in. Nice save by Campbell and bounces out wide. Ortega trying to track it down.
That's a good first save for Charlie Campbell. I think that gives you some confidence as a goalkeeper. Get that save out of the way, settle in defensively.
Hillman flips it. Scotty Rose Grouty from X. And a trencher can't pick it up. And as you said, second uncharacteristic turnover.
But credit the Stony Brook defense. They were coming out to play, and this isn't a team that Carolina faces often, so they don't know the style of defense. And Jenny Levy admitted to that in our coach's call. She said, we're not familiar with this type of defense, so we really have to work to find the open lanes. And Stony Brook jumping in front of those passes and getting them an opportunity on the offensive end to put the ball in the back of the net.
Technically, that goes down as the first turnover, as off of that whistle, UNC was fortunate to get the ball back. This is Ellie Mazzara trying to cut in. And a nice job! First shot, first opportunity, and Mazzara at 5-1 sticks it.
Ellie Mazzara is having a breakout sophomore season. She is just a sophomore, and she's almost quadrupled her point production from last year as a freshman. I love this take. Not afraid. Didn't even really get that far inside the 8-meter. Brooklyn Walker-Welch D'd up on her. Love that shot. You got to feel good when you get on the board first, and you're Stony Brook, and you're the underdog. That's the national conversation. They're the underdog. They like being that underdog.
Ellie Mazzara having one heck of a tournament, her 8th of the season. 8th of the tournament play. As you see, Joe Spallina, part of the U.S. staff with Jenny Levy in his 11th year at Stony Brook.
And embodies Long Island lacrosse.
Absolutely.
I think of Joe Spallina, that's what I think of. And he took over this team that won 4 games in 2011. His ability to turn this program over and make it a powerhouse and have them force to be in that national conversation. Love the athletes on the field. Love the recruits that he gets from Long Island. It's really family oriented, the
total
team.
Total family. Has the number one defense and goals against average on the year. Very prideful of that. 14 games in single digits they have held opponents this season. Well, we'll go to the Tar Heels quickly as they take the second draw.
It's a new rule in women's lacrosse this year. Alternate possession. So a draw infraction occurs. You're not going to redraw. Help speed up that game a little bit.
Scotty Rose Grouty had Andy Aldave 31 in a flash. Aldave with the ball now up top. Good communication. You can hear it by the Seawolves defensively.
And you can hear it coming from Charlie Campbell. I recognize that voice. She played at Virginia for 5 years. She is communicating with her defense, and that is so huge when you got a leader in cage that can really give your defense some of that oomph.
Jenny Levy told us yesterday that her attack's going to have a lot of patience. these first few possessions. Ever so important. Hard whistle, and the ball will go back to the Seawolves off the check.
Zone defense is hard to play against, especially when you're North Carolina and you play such a gauntlet schedule in the ACC. A lot of ACC teams play man-to-man.
Tar Heels with just 10.7 turnovers per game. In goal for the Tar Heels tonight, making her 74th straight start. Taylor Marino, 19-0 on the year. She was out here early, really trying to soak in what will definitely be her final home game.
I'm not ready for her to leave college lacrosse. We got to find a way for the NCAA to give her a few more years because she is an absolute beast in cage, such a leader for this UNC squad. So much personality, so much talent.
And up for the test here. Second opportunity on the attack for the Seawolves.
And a very patient offense for Stony Brook. A lot of times when you play North Carolina, they lull you into being complacent and you sleep, and they're gonna jump you on defense.
Nice on ball pick there by the Seawolves. Carolina reads it. And Taylor Marino scoops it up. Little speed action here by Marino.
She's so confident outside of the cage. It honestly makes me nervous every time she does this. I've been on the field a lot for this Carolina team, and she has no fear. Gone are the days where goalies aren't athletic anymore.
Ortega to Aldave, and a hard whistle. And it will actually go the opposite way on the charge.
This has been a very controversial call in women's lacrosse, especially this year. That's tough. That's a tough call to make. They almost made contact at the same time, and the charge call is a little bit different defensively. You don't have to have your feet set like basketball. You just have to have defensive positioning. But according to the officials, which I give them a lot of credit, it's difficult in women's lacrosse. We don't make it easy with our rules. They deem that a charge on Andy Aldave.
Well, and the game's just, we were talking about this today, has gotten so fast.
So fast.
Players are quicker, stronger.
And I've heard a lot of conversations of, do we need instant replay? And I just don't know if that's the answer. You know, the game's already too long. Maybe give coaches a challenge, but I don't know if instant replay is the answer. We have it in the booth, but it's difficult.
For the time limit, possibly. Kaylin Hart, number 14, with the ball. They run the weave so well. The Seawolves do, they know exactly where their teammate's going to be, patient in the weave.
And defensively, UNC was practicing this week. They were ready for this weave, the Seawolf weave. I love the matchup, Emma Trenchard, Ellie Massera oftentimes. Emma Trenchard, she's gonna be D'd up on the best offensive player. And Massera, just a sophomore. You gotta feel good about that in
Absolutely.
Some ways.
Nice cut back inside there by Zapolsky. A shot clock violation by the Seawolves. Much needed stop for the defense.
Huge stop for UNC.
Good hustle on the run out there by Julia Dorsey.
She's got those soccer legs.
Yes, she does.
Sport athlete at North Carolina. So impressive. They put her back on defense to give her some rest, and she does play two sports and they're all in season, but an incredible athlete.
And all on this field. Doris Field. Little quicker. Here's Brooke Newman.
Much better ball movement on this possession.
Totally.
You gotta move the ball and look for the open player in the zone, and it's on the opposite side of where everyone else is.
Second free position for Carolina. Brooklyn Newman will have the opportunity. She stares down Campbell. Over the top and over the shoulder, and we're tied at one.
We have got ourselves a game, folks. North Carolina getting on the board. 6:38 left. Watch out, Seawolves have come to play.
Stony Brook will not touch foot on North Carolina campus with an ounce of fear. We're going there to win a lacrosse game. We're not going there to bend our knee. We're not going there to kiss the rings. We're going there to win a lacrosse game. We respect North Carolina immensely. They are awesome. Awesome. And they have no wins. No losses. No loss. Undefeated. Undefeated. Okay? Yeah, we know. We know.
I love that coach talk from Joe Spallina. He embraces this underdog mentality and he transfers it to her team. And they're intense about the fact that we haven't been to North Carolina. We haven't been to a Final Four. But the student athletes, they don't care. They're here to play Long Island lacrosse. And they have this mantra, it's us versus everyone. And that's what they talk about all the time. And I mean, they love a challenge.
The time is now. One of the other Seawolves mantras, and I think for Stony Brook, one thing that Joe Spallina has continuously done is try to play the most difficult non-conference schedule. The road that he's running into now is, it used to be easy back in 2011-12, but now teams don't want to take that chance and ruin their RPI.
Because they're gritty and they're tough and you never know what you're going to get with them, but you know it's going to be a physical battle. The 2017-2018 seasons really stand out to me for the Stony Brook team. It's when they started to get national respect that they deserve to be in this sort of conversation. They're playing hard teams out of conference and they've really put their name on the map.
Right. And a difficult year for Stony Brook as well. They will be leaving the America East, heading to the CAA. So they could not play for a conference championship. They came in as the at-large with the AC. And they got it done. Talk about that grittiness.
When we talked to L.A. Massera, she said, I want to win a conference championship, but I felt bad for the fifth years who really wanted to win. But hey, a natty is a lot better than winning a conference title.
Here's Kaylin Hart. She goes low, and somehow Tara Marino smothers it up. Kind of ricocheted off the post a little bit, was hanging out there.
So reactionary, Kaylin Marino.
Yeah. Emily Nall will receive it here. Nice pass up front to Emily. She looks for assistance as Ortega takes over. How do you feel the Tar Heels are handling this zone so far? You think they're trying to kind of chess match it out a little bit?
You have to feel out the zone. You have to move the ball. Everybody touch sort of back-to-back yard lacrosse, youth lacrosse, where everyone touches the ball so you can work the defense. Tire the zone defense out. It's extremely difficult to play defense. You're in that crouched position like in basketball. So for North Carolina, the patience that I'm seeing is much better than what we saw at the beginning of the game.
What a play up over the top! The Tar Heels, and they take the lead 2-1. Geiersbach with the one timer. What a leap.
She's been a fantastic addition, transfer from Richmond. She's a lefty, so she gives this attack a completely different look. She's put on inside roll clinics, but she can also cut in the 8 meter and feed. Love that grab, so athletic to reach down, possess it, place it around Charlie Campbell. Not easy to do, but beautiful goal there by Sam Geiersbach. 28th goal this season.
That was an athletic catch and shoot. Scotty Rose Grounding with the assist.
You gotta pick your poison.
Right.
With this UNC squad. And stop Jamie Ortega. Well, Sam Geiersbach's gonna go off for Scotty Rose Grounding. They're so lethal on attack.
Olivia Dirks now will step into the circle to take the draw for UNC. Dirks came over from Penn State through the portal. Ball will go back to the Seawolves.
Great pressure on that ride. Jamie Ortega, a big part of the ride for UNC. One of her greatest qualities as an attacker. I know she scores a lot of goals, gets a lot of assists, puts a lot of points on the board, but if you can ride That's huge. That's so critical for your team.
The defender there for the Seawolves. See what they have in their bag of tricks here on the offensive attack. As the Seawolves, after that initial start with Becerra's goal, have now been held scoreless for a little over 8 minutes. Becerra with the ball.
Ellie cuts back inside.
Nice save there by Taylor Marino.
And great defense by Emma Trencher. She was forcing Becerra inside, and Becerra kind of took what she gave her. Instead, I thought a better slot selection would have been to go around closer to the elbow. I love the gnat sounds from the field. All that communication on defense.
Ooh! Worsberger looked like maybe she was trying to pass it off ball to the side of the cage.
She was open.
Wide open.
But it's that zone defense. If you're not used to that type of pressure, Stony Brook plays a completely different style than what Carolina does, which I think makes these teams so fun when they do match up. But credit Stony Brook defensively. They're making it difficult for Carolina.
Four turnovers now for the Tar Heels. Tar Heels trying to match that intensity right now is Claire Levy. 42 in blue for Stony Brook. Great story. Coach Bellino was telling us today, loves Levy's heart. Knew right away he was actually going to see another player. Ball that comes loose right into Marino's hands.
And back to Claire Levy, no club experience. Did not play a lick of club.
Look at this ball up to Ortega. A little too much hotness on it. And Campbell scoops it up and in. But there's a great thought process for any young student athlete coming out of high school. Levy was not looked at, didn't play travel ball. Defense there is riding it out for Carolina as Dirk scoops it up.
And the physicality, we talked about it at the beginning of the game. Full display. Physicality is on full display. These teams want to win. This means a lot.
Becerra goes low. Second rebound. Nice job there on the turnover as Kaylin Hart got it to Becerra.
And hit the pipe. Ricocheted off the pipe. Hit a player back to Moreno. Very uncharacteristic first half for so many different reasons. Yeah.
Wasn't clean, hasn't been clean here as we close in on a minute of play. In case you joined us late, Stony Brook with their first opportunity. Ellen Becerra with the goal, 1-0. Carolina has come back with 2. And that is where we stand.
You can see Haley Dillon serving as that backer role. She's so tall, so good at it, so strong. Coming back from an ACL injury. It's made such great strides this season.
One last run here, an opportunity as Levy races it downfield. Plenty of time for Stony Brook.
Good decision to settle it. It takes about 7 to 8 seconds to score in transition, but this was the right call. Hold it for the last second. You want that last shot. But they do need to attack because the clock is running down.
Defense stands tall for the Tar Heels. And after one quarter of play, the winner will get Northwestern and move on to the national semifinals. 2-1 in the books. Double duties for our coaches tonight. Prominent at the college level, Jenny Levy, also the head coach for the United States women's lacrosse team, and part of that staff, Joe Spallina, at her side.
Lots of familiarity with these two coaches. They're friends off the field, but tonight they are certainly enemies and they both want to beat each other. But look at how many Seawolves and Tar Heels we got on this Team USA roster. Kylie O'Miller, I don't think you can talk about Stony Brook without talking about Kylie Miller. She's incredible what she's done. Now she's playing professional. She's playing with the USA team. So fun to see Molly Hendrick, Tar Heel great.
This is a Team USA roster that certainly the best of the best and will be chasing gold in the very near future. But right now they're chasing NCAA championships for their respective schools. Jenny Levy, you could read lips very easily during that timeout break.
Take care of the ball. Not once, not twice, but at least three times what I could see up here in the booth. And she's right. They're a little complacent with their play. You don't often see the turnovers that happen in the middle of the field, and you certainly don't see them on the offensive end as much, but you have to credit the Stony Brook defense. They're giving them a hard time in that backer going in that zone. It's difficult, and Stony Brook, they pride themselves in that defense. That's the heart of their team.
Six turnovers, only three shots, so they have more turnovers than shots are the Tar Heels right now. Charlotte Verhorst will get set here in the circle against Ali Mastriani, Towerton finalist. We are set for quarter number two. The winner will get Northwestern next week in the national semifinals.
Such a battle at the draw circle. I love watching the box out that happened. There's so much basketball and hockey crossover, but that circle, that 3v3 in between those lines is so physical.
Here's Joe Spallina from the sideline directing his team on the attack here. UNC extending that defense out. Trying to work on that on-ball pick.
And lots of screens, and that's something defensively that Phil Barnes, the defensive coordinator for UNC, they're working on in practice this week. How do you jump the screen? How do you talk through? How do you communicate?
Deny and push to one side. Trencher on Hart there. Under 20. Nall's getting away with a little push. 10 seconds. Seawolves trying to get to work here. And the Tar Heels locking it down inside the 12. Shot is off, and it's errant. Goes back to the Tar Heels.
It did hit Taylor Marino, which would mean that it would be a reset.
You called it off the tip.
Let's see, the officials are going to discuss. You can hear the
fans.
Gotta
love Matt's sound, right?
You can hear the fans.
Crowd is settled in nicely here on a Thursday night in Chapel Hill.
So it's going to stay with North Carolina.
They give it back to Carolina. So they had switched one way, went back the opposite way. Marino has the ball, and we'll look to outlet it here.
Joe Spallina on the sidelines. Certainly not happy about that call, but got to reset.
Hillman races in to Jamie Ortega. Mastriani with some real high off of Charlie Campbell and out of play. Literally. Mastriani in a double team spins.
And I love Wurzburger's versatility. You often see her behind the cage, but she's in the 8 meter. Stony Brook is really funneling her and forcing her to go out and be that playmaker from a different quadrant of the field.
Yeah. Here's Wurzburger with the ball. Clips that on the defense. And the goal as Elizabeth Hillman picks it up, her second of the night.
Elizabeth Hillman has really become such an integral part of this Tar Heel midfield. She had an injury in 2020, but she's back and she's better than ever. So quick on that first step on the 8 meter. When a game is close like this, those 8 meters, those gifts, really matter. And for Carolina to capitalize off that, that is huge for them. Big confidence boost. 3-1 UNC, really low scoring game.
Three unanswered goals by the Tar Heels. 10th goal of the season there for Hillman. Free position has been very good to the Tar Heels tonight.
And it's a lot more difficult than they make it seem. It's not like basketball where the free throw is uncontested. You know, there's sticks flying in front of you. And this is something that they practice. We practice at Virginia. At the end of every practice, we would have 5-10 minutes built in to practice the 8 meters, practice what it feels like under pressure with someone on the right side and the left side of you, sticks in the passing lane. It's difficult.
Fourth consecutive draw won by Carolina. The racing speed of Levy drops it for Mazzara. Good movement of the ball by the Seawolves. And Marino is there for the save.
Amazing save and great transition down the field for Stony Brook, but that's why Taylor Moreno is Taylor Moreno, because she makes saves like that in the clutch to give her offense that boost. Now it's a quick possession back for UNC on the offensive end. That's huge.
I don't recall in any of the games that we've done this year such as many consistent long outlets that we've seen tonight from Moreno up to Knowles or Aldave in that last case, really trying to catch the Seawolves. And here's Aldave now racing in, pulling back out.
She'll get on the 8 meter.
Indy Aldave coming over from Notre Dame.
And Kyle Zapolsky, number 4 behind her, fouled her. Transfer from Albany, also phenomenal.
Absolutely. And a shot low. You can hear that in the heart of the glove of Charlie Campbell.
You gotta shoot around the goalie. You don't see Andy Aldave miss a lot.
No. That was a funk.
I love listening to Charlie Campbell on the cage. She's directing her defense. She's saying top left, top right, helping her defense find the ball quickly, because they're not in that man-to-man defense.
Dana, we've seen so many players blossom through these second opportunities of the portal. Andy Aldave's, you know, one of them who just gave up the ball there. Charlie Campbell is certainly one of her accordingly. We could talk all day about how she has flourished with another opportunity at Maryland. And Campbell's probably one of the most humblest through that whole experience this past year.
She is, and probably one of the smartest players, student athletes that I've met in a long time. Just incredible, and you know, her quote, her saying is, it's cool to care, and she feels welcome at the Stony Brook squad, and she's got a lot of energy, a great personality, and I wish everybody could see her off ball. When the ball's on the offensive end for Stony Brook, because she's jumping around in the goal circle. Great energy, great personality. I love the transfer portal. I think it's benefited a lot of teams. I hope it doesn't get into a situation like football and basketball, and I don't think it will. But it's been great to see student-athletes get an opportunity to go to a different institution, get their graduate degree, play on a different team.
And Charlie won't be done when her season is done here. She told us that she is going to continue on. We saw Charlie at Virginia the day everything closed down with COVID. Virginia was supposed to take on Syracuse. She told us at that time she wanted to pursue being a trauma doctor. She has now changed that to wanting to be a pediatric trauma doctor.
Either way, incredible career choice.
great hustle effort by both teams right now as they scramble on the field. We kind of expected the physical play. We talked about that in our own meeting, production meeting. And keeping cool was something Jenny Levy talked about consistently in practice yesterday.
There's some chippiness. And I think rightfully so. Stony Brook deserves to have a chip on their shoulder. They've gotten shafted a few years by the selection committee, and a lot of people underestimate them.
Yes. But they've fought through as the eighth seed once again. Looking for that first semifinal appearance.
It's good to see Melissa Scannoni in the game. She's got a rocket of a left shot on that elbow.
Rips it from the side.
I put a radar gun on her during the ACC tournament in South Bend. First shot, 81 miles per hour. Second shot, 82. Insane.
When she just rips it from the, does that sidewinder, you can hear it.
It's a thing of beauty.
Stony Brook started this game shooting 1-for-1. Ellie Mazzara with the goal was 1-0. First opportunity off of possession. They're now 1-for-7. They needed that one on that possession. They're back within one.
Jaden Hample with the spin move. Comes from a really athletic family. She's a soccer player. Watch this. Love the setup. Not the most pretty start to the offensive set, but they were able to squeak through that zone in the defense. Great job finding the seam. Stony Brook, don't count them out.
All playing for the national championship, Carolina in 2016. That was their second of two national championships, the victory over Maryland. 2017, here come the Terps once again. 16-13, what an epic game that one was for University of Maryland, 14th title.
Such a dynasty that Maryland has created. And then James Madison, they're getting in the mix. Defeated Boston College, 16-15. First title in program history.
And then this is what will be a rematch of the last time these two teams met. But now we will be in the semifinals, the Terps holding on 12-10. And then in 2021, the first opportunity for the win for the Boston College Eagles, who will now make their fifth consecutive semifinal appearance.
It was exciting for Boston College. We crowned a new champion last year, which is great. It's a testament to what Acacia Walker has built at Boston College, all of the players, and the game has gotten better.
Yes.
You see the diversity in the teams that are winning. It's not just Maryland and Northwestern. You're seeing other teams get in the mix there. And for North Carolina, they remember the pain from last year. They want to get back to championship weekend. They want to get to that championship game, and they want to win.
And I think it all changed for Jenny Levy, who started the program here 27 years ago. All started back in 2012 for her. Revamped the program and the thought process. Won it in 2013. And Allie Mastrielli was in seventh grade and in the stands that game.
Wild. And it's remarkable. They were in the Final Four the first 2 years of the program for Jenny Levy. So what she has built at North Carolina is extremely, extremely impressive.
Stony Brook taking a timeout here. We're going to stay with you and talk a little bit more about Jenny Levy and her prominence in that 2012 into 13 season. Mastriani was telling us that, you know, I knew my parents took me to that game. It was a great game. And I knew right from then that I wanted to be a Tar Heel, and she was hooked.
And what an incredible job that she's done. I love the conversations I've had with Jenny Levy, and she used to watch Roy Williams practice, the then basketball coach for UNC, and they had this real conversation of what it takes to be elite. And he told her, you may never win, and you have to be okay with that. It's really hard to reach the top level. That was in 2012, and then in 2013, they won their first national championship. So I would love to have been a fly in that room between Roy Williams and Jenny Levy, but what she's done for this program to create not just great players, but a culture. You can't win without a culture. You can have great individuals, great student athletes, but if you don't have culture, if you don't invest in your players and have a relationship, you're not winning.
Right. And with Mastroianni there, she comes in that freshman year, scores 14 goals, goes down, tears her ACL, grade 3 tear, hasn't repaired. She had to learn really basically how to walk again. They wrap the nerve with shark collagen. So she's got shark in her, provides extra support to that nerve and to the bone area, and now we're a Towariton finalist.
And you would never know.
No.
She's a gazelle on the field. So fast, so quick. One of the best two-way middies. I don't think two-way midfielders get enough credit. What they do both on the offensive end and the defensive end, and you're running 7 to 8 miles a game. Extremely impressive in the way that Ally Mastroianni can handle any defensive matchup and then go down on the other end and put the ball in the back of the net.
Two stingy defenses here had a great opportunity out of this timeout on this possession for the Seawolves to tie this game up. Certainly the closest of the three complete games to this point on the day. Straight up by the Tar Heels against the Seawolves.
Very patient in their offensive set.
No! Could not catch up with the Seawolves. And how about that? As out of the timeout, it's Hample once again, and the crowd to its feet. We're tied up at 3.
Huge goal for Stony Brook, and they're so patient. You can hear the sidelines yelling 30. Once the shot clock hits 30, they're going to start attacking. I love this 1v1 matchup on the elbow. Not the best angle.
No.
At all, but doesn't matter. Tampa puts the ball in the back of the net. So athletic, the speed. Look at the fiery passion. I love it. Not often do you get past Taylor Moreno. I know she probably wants that save back.
But Jaden Hample actually debuted in her college career on this very field a year ago. Having a solid night. 2 goals in about a minute and a half for the Seawolves.
Black runs in the family. Her sister, Emma, plays for the great Michelle Tumalo at Army. Came flying. No call. I love the different strategy UNC has at the draw. They're really versatile. Sometimes you see Olivia Dirks, you oftentimes see Andy Aldave. Ally Mastroianni is probably the primary draw taker, but they have a lot of depth at that position. So if something's not working, they can rotate in another player. You gotta match up your sticks. You almost have to work together on the draw circle with the opponents, but it's all about fit and the way the sticks fit, and you wanna win the draw. Huge, possession is huge.
Campbell's not gonna have a voice left in goal by the time this one's done.
Yeah, have to give her some of these cough drops we have up in the booth. Exclusively here, Charlie Campbell.
Absolutely.
That was a 3 seconds call.
Here we go, Scotty.
A little over 8 minutes now with UNC without a goal. Scotty Rose Browning. Getting ready to whip it.
I'll start. About 2 Stony Brook players.
Not quite sure what Sabella was thinking on that play.
Both players that had to stay behind. So this gives Scotty Rosgrani a better angle.
Grani goes high. It may have ricocheted just a little bit off of Campbell's stick.
Surprised you can see. I can't see like that.
Just a little bit. That's my bionica. Turnover. Ortega trying to keep control.
That ball goes on the ground, Leah. And not one, but two Stony Brook players.
The reason for that dump in, shot clock was winding down. That was really the only option that Andy Aldave had. So ball will go back over to the Seawolves.
It's a good strategy. Mm-hmm. You want Stony Brook to start as far away from your defense if you're North Carolina.
Turnovers have been a nemesis for the Tar Heels. They average a little over 10 a game.
Hear Joe Spallina on the sidelines. Patience and poise. They're doing a really good job. North Carolina is fiery on defense.
Of course, Spallina in his Tom Landry suit tonight in this 90% humidity. Give him a lot of credit for that.
He says he likes to wear the suit because he knows if he moves around too much, he's going to sweat. So it helps him stay calm and stay put so he's not pacing.
Sarah gets pushed out of the screen. No call. Gabby Hall takes it on the chin as well.
Good call by the officials.
Two no calls. In check. We're going to start something outside the 12. 30 seconds on the shot clock. Closing in on 2 minutes. Till halftime.
It's incredible defense by Stony Brook. They're not even letting North Carolina get into the 12 without pressure.
Here comes Ortega, a little flip to Scotty Rosgrani. She's pushed to the ground, a hard check.
I'm a little
check
high.
That was Wurzburger, actually. Knocked to the ground, and here's Ortega. Campbell with a knockdown save.
You don't often see Jamie Ortega miss, but that's the fiery, intense, physical defense that Stony Brook, they pride themselves on that.
There is a lot of activity in that crease area. And you better be ready with your goggles on straight if you're flying through looking for the ball.
And it's difficult. You can only absorb so many of those hits.
Right.
That was a cross check into Wurzburger.
So if you're thinking about the hit, which could easily happen because you might have gotten knocked one time pretty good.
It can throw you off the game a little
bit. Absolutely.
You know, sometimes anticipating the hit is difficult.
You hear Coach Polina? Poise. Campbell already has two goals, trying to work herself in off a null. Zapolsky gives it off and up over the top. Look at this! Stony Brook with its second lead of the game, 4-3. Three unanswered goals by the Seawolves.
And this all starts with Charlie Campbell with the save. Oftentimes your defense, and specifically your goalkeeper, gives the offense some juice. And you see that. Siobhan Rafferty, incredible poise. You got to close that double if you're North Carolina. Slipped right through, right past Moreno. She's fired up. Number 16, Stony Brook. Came back from an ACL at the end of 2021. We're seeing a lot of ACL injuries. I hope we can fix that. But she does a little bit of everything at a very high level. She's a two-way middy. She doesn't miss a run of defense. Doesn't want to come off the field. Incredible competitor.
Key piece for Stony Brook, 2-ton. All-America East. Nall scoops it up. 20 seconds to go till halftime. Dorsey to Hall. Looking for the cutter. 5 seconds.
No go.
No go, and Campbell will hold on.
Wow, this is impressive by Stony Brook. This is only the second time that UNC has trailed at halftime. The first time, Boston College in the ACC championship game just a few weeks ago, so they're not used to going into the locker room down.
Number one defense in goals against average. Standing tall against the top seed in Carolina. The Seawolves head to halftime with a 4-3 lead. Sound on after this. Solid crowd here in Chapel Hill, North Carolina to watch Stony Brook and the Tar Heels, the Seawolves. Their fans are tearing it up right now as they lead it 4-3 as we get set to start the third quarter of play. Dana, defense wins championships. Talked about Stony Brook being the number one defense in the country, and they were solid, locked down.
This is the physical battle that you and I were hoping for. Right. The physicality is on display tonight, and I think the defense for Stony Brook, they're making it really difficult for North Carolina to find the back of the net. And what I think is so impressive is all of that leadership. It's starting with Charlie Campbell. Haley Dillon on the defensive end is a big part of that as well. And the communication and the spark that she is giving her offense. Kyle Zapolsky here. Love this shot by number 16, Siobhan Rafferty. There's no fear for the Stony Brook squad. They don't care that they're playing the number one undefeated team in the country. They want to win this game. They've never been to a Final Four, and they feel that this year they deserve it.
11 turnovers on the game for Carolina. Stony Brook led it 1-0. UNC answered with 3 unanswered goals. Stony Brook responded with 3 of their own. Hample with 2 for the Seawolves. And the swagger from Stony Brook really showing through right now. And playing really relaxed and calm.
You have to feel good about that, going into the locker room if you're Stony Brook. It's not often that Carolina goes into halftime trailing. You just don't see it. It's only happened twice this season, and the first time was Boston College in the ACC championship. So there's plenty of game left to play, but this has to give confidence to Stony Brook and really solidify what they've thought of themselves all year round, is that they deserve to be in this conversation.
Season low, 3 goals at the half for Carolina. The winner will get Northwestern in the national semifinals.
It'll be North Carolina ball.
Pressure coming on the right from Stony Brook. Let's see if the Tar Heels on this first opportunity, Dana, work the shot clock as deep as they did against the Seawolves zone. Mastriani directing.
It's all about taking care of the ball. We talked about that in the first half. Take care of the ball, be settled, be calm, and work the ball. Let the ball do the work. There's going to be an open player if you have that quick ball movement.
Ortega's been held scoreless. She's inside the eight as Mastriani gets knocked. Gets the shot off, but Campbell is there for the save.
And her ability to weave her way in and out of those defenders, but it's difficult to beat a zone and or a backer in a 1v1 situation. You do have to move the ball, find a backside where that Carolina player is open. You have to think, are they feeling the pressure?
Pressure coming here. And over the line for the Seawolves to get started in their attack. First attack opportunity. Pizarro, who got the scoring going, the speedster.
UNC 6 all over that. As soon as she dropped it to maybe take a shot, the cross check was there, back check was there. Good job by Emma Trenchard.
Hart. Seawolves need to hurry here. Mazzara rips the shot. Shot clock was at 4. Defense for the Tar Heels locked it down.
Ellie Massera putting some pressure there on Taylor Moreno.
Good hustle. Trying to re-catch up here with Gabby Hall.
As soon as that ball crosses that 30, you can hear Charlie Campbell. Top right. Ball's top right. The communication.
Jamie Ortega has been held scoreless. She has 64 goals on the season with 40 assists. And Seawolves has done a great job locking her down defensively in the first half of play. Ortega up top, being knocked out of it by Claire Levy, 42. A little bit quicker with the movement of the ball. Here's Ortega.
That's the backside. That is how you beat this type of defense for Stony Brook. Oftentimes it yields shooting space, but you gotta find the backside girl.
Campbell staring down Ortega here. Jamie goes low, second opportunity. Two big saves by Charlie Campbell.
That has to feel good about one of the best players in the country in Jamie Ortega. Charlie Campbell getting that hot stop.
Oh, third opportunity.
Spoke too soon.
Yeah, ricocheted out. And Carolina comes up with it to tie this one up at 4. Hot rebound right into the hands of the Tar Heels, and the Matadors are going on the sidelines.
We love the sideline celebrations. What a series of saves for Charlie Campbell. One save, two saves, and then Sam Geiersbach. She's ready. She's ready when that ball ricochets off. Not a ton of angle. Goal line extended, but Sam Geiersbach, she has that left hand. It just gives her a different angle. I've been so impressed with her play. Her second goal tonight when Jamie Ortega has been held scoreless. It's the next woman up mentality that Carolina thrives with.
The lockdown defense of the Seawolves locked Carolina in for a little over 16 minutes. And we're knotted up at 4.
This is incredible. I'm sure it's not incredible if you're UNC.
No.
But from us, our standpoint, our viewpoint, this is the best game that Carolina has got all year. The most competitive physical game.
through three quarters. Verhulst, patient, waiting for some help, brings it back out. Sabella gives it up to Zapolsky.
Zapolsky's done such a great job transferring from Albany, and Coach Polina told us, I was sick of coaching against her. I was happy when she came in the portal. She's a Long Island kid. We scooped her up. I don't want to play against her anymore. Just such an incredible talent.
I saw her in the portal. Like, he's all excited. I saw her in the portal. I wasn't going to let her go. 2018 America East. All rookie at Albany. Now donning the colors of the Seawolves. Here come the Tar Heels, though. No. Where's Berger up front? Scotty Rose Browning flashes.
You may be wondering, is Nall going to take it in? She was a pure goal scorer in high school. She has a lot of familiarity finding the back of the cage, but good decision, dish it off, give herself a break. She just ran 70, 80 yards.
Good speed. Number one in white for Carolina is Olivia Dirks with the ball. Take a little stutter step there. Great movement defensively by the Seawolves. Woo! Wurzberger would have had to have made a heck of a catch on that ball.
Usually that works. Jamie Ortega threads the needle quite well.
Yep.
But this Stony Brook defense, they're ready for it.
And just how stingy is this defense by the Seawolves? Carolina is now above their game average in turnovers. Already 11 on the night.
Now you hear Taylor Moreno with the mat sounds, ball left.
Great job by our crew and our team who was out here very early today to bring you the sights and sounds of the game. So we appreciate everything they've done to bring you some great visuals and sound tonight.
Gives you a look inside what it's like to be a goalkeeper.
Stutter step by Hart. Long rebound comes back to Moreno. He smothers that one. Oh!
That's big. That's big if you're Stony Brook. Great takeaway by Jamie Ortega. Relentless in that ride, gets possession, a much needed possession. She's gonna settle it down. Good decision.
Cole Humphrey now from the outside.
Look at how high they're pressuring out.
Not afraid to come up beyond the 12 was needed there, a little check.
Because they know they have that support in the backer that if they do make a misstep and a Carolina player gets around them, they have that second line of defense.
Mastriani.
That's the pass.
Aldave tries to draw. Humphrey with a good check in the back. Levy's not fazed.
It's that opposite elbow. They're open every time. They're just struggling to configure it.
Hard whistle. And I will have to say, for the physicality of this game, the officials have done a great job keeping the cards in their pocket and allowing the players to play. It's been very balanced on the field tonight.
There's a difference between being aggressive and physical and fouling.
Absolutely.
And I think this is a perfect display of that tonight. It's hard, though. You get the emotions going, and this is a big game, and it means a lot to both UNC and Stony Brook. You can often have those emotional fouls, but both teams so far, very much in check.
lot of traffic up top of Seawolves as they try to create some confusion. Open up the play for Mazzara, and her second of the night. That has the Seawolves fans on their feet.
That's huge. Ellie Mazzara, breakout sophomore campaign. Almost a junior now that they're done school, but what a way to take a 1v1. Brooklyn Walker Welch, great defender, but Stony Brook, they are climbing their way to the top.
The NCAA women's lacrosse coverage continues next weekend for the semifinals. The action begins Friday, the 27th, 3 Eastern on ESPNU. For more information on the 2022 Women's Lacrosse Championship, visit NCAA.com, your home for all NCAA championships. Seawolf fans, there's a lot of game left, but they are feeling it. Their team defensively has really locked in on Ali Mastriani and this offensive attack of Carolina.
They have every right to be proud through these first three quarters. This is the closest game this year that anyone's played to Carolina. It's incredible. The physicality, we've talked about it all game long, the aggression and the emotion, the will to win. Both of these teams deserve to move on, but only one can.
Out of the timeout. And at the end of this one, when the clock strikes zero, the winner will get Northwestern next Friday in the national semifinals.
Who really dominated Syracuse in that third quarterfinal game. I was a little bit surprised by that.
Yeah, totally.
The first meeting, Syracuse lost in overtime.
100%. Maryland and Boston College also advancing today. Congratulations to both of those schools. The Terps on quite a run right now themselves. That'll be a great classic semifinal matchup.
The Terps are back. Anyone who counted them out last year? No. Libby May, Abby Bosco, Aurora Accordingly on fire.
Yeah, actually, in another school, we talked about Charlie Campbell and how she's risen through the portal. Vivian Dirks, Amy Aldave, we go right down the list. Abby Bosco, accordingly.
The women's lacrosse world has benefited greatly from the transfer portal.
Absolutely.
You're seeing all these different matchups and players that, you know, originally were committed to another school spend their fifth year somewhere else. It's awesome.
Aldave going down! And
Chip,
wow.
Let's take a look at this foul. Let's see. Another controversial call. She catches it. I want to say that the Stony Brook defender had the space, but she was falling before she got to Andy Aldave. Don't
correct.
You agree?
Yes. Yes, I would.
I give the officials a lot of credit. That's
it happens
very
fast.
Difficult.
It happens so fast. Especially at this level.
But the defender had the space, which is the rule in women's lacrosse. But she might have been a little low to the ground, anticipating maybe the shot coming. But that's the second charge on Andy.
That's the second charge on Andy. Yes, you are correct. Picked up one early in the game. And a big possession here for Stony Brook now. Ellie Mazzara with the ball, number 12 in blue. Mazzara who got the scoring going. And then just capped it. As Hart cuts back into the opposite side by Trenchard.
Good tip on the stick by Trenchard.
Roll by Mazzara. Nice job by Marino to gather it in. Quick outlet out to Emma Trenchard here. Up the field. Dorsey.
good poise by Julia Dorsey. Three Sea Wolves jerseys. She made the right pass, right decision. UNC, they're struggling offensively. With the defense.
Hesitation.
It's the hesitation, it's the quick passes. That's a flag.
Agave with the opportunity now. This is from less than another field, she picked up the charge.
Much needed. This is a much needed goal for North Carolina. Huge.
Shoulder of Campbell, and we're tied back up at five.
That's a great score by the grad transfer. Off the line, quick step, does a good job protecting her stick. Changes the levels ever so slightly, keeps it in her right hand. Shoots stick side of Charlie Campbell, which is oftentimes a very difficult shot to put in the back of the net, but there was some emotion and fire behind that. Got called for two charges. You can hear her saying, let's go on the field. Much needed score by North Carolina, and we're tied.
48th of the season for Andy Aldave. Close on the draws in this game, 7-5, the advantage to the Tar Heels. Was trying to tippy-toe the sidelines.
I like the change-up on the draw circle with Emily Knowles. You sometimes see her up there. She's got a lot of physicality, and when they need the ball, they put her on the circle, and Jenny Levy describes her as spicy.
Spicy.
She is spicy.
She's a spice girl.
Sporty Spice.
Sporty Spice, there you go.
That's the Spice Girl that I wanted to be growing up. We had a Spice Girl club in my neighborhood. It's a big deal. I don't know if these student athletes know about Spice Girls, but they need to, because it's a big deal.
Walker Welch, the young, bright defender who works with Emma Trenchard in the back for Carolina, doing a nice job allowing Moreno to see that ball in solid. Here's Dorsey using her speed now out of the back.
I like this decision. Kick it back for Walker Welch, you mentioned her. Switch the fields. Number 45 for Carolina, Brooklyn Walker Welch. Great temperament. She's young. She's a young defender, and she's getting to learn from players like Emma Trenchard and Emily Knowles, and she has come in and fit in so seamlessly into this defensive end.
She was telling us that yesterday. She said, you know, I looked up to Emma Trenchard, and now I'm playing alongside of her, so I try to soak in everything that she does every single day. Nice check there with the stick. Scotty Rose Brownie picks it up.
And she came in with such a great base of knowledge, so she's just building on top of that, the foundation that she already has. As such a young defender, I can't wait to watch her in a Carolina jersey. She's just going to skyrocket in her career.
10 seconds. Agave was open for a flash. Carolina's got to hurry. Agave tries to get the shot off. The rebound! And the up and under by Rosberger. Carolina with the lead. And that will close out this third quarter of play.
Wow. Great ball movement by UNC. Nice little spin move. Sam Geiersbach kicks it. It changes levels. The ball goes to a different quadrant. Great job by number 13. Right on the crease, right on the doorstep. Ricochets that ball. Great job getting it in the back of the net. Huge development
from Kaitlyn Wurzberger. Excuse me, the ACC leader for this Carolina team in assists. That much needed goal right now. Back-to-back goals by the Tar Heels. Jenny Levy looking on.
She's consulting with another Carolina great, Emily Paros, who runs the offense. Jenny gives a lot of responsibility to her staff.
Does.
And Emily Paros has done a great job. I've watched her in the huddle breaking it down.
One more quarter left to play. The winner will get Northwestern. Carolina has led every single game this season going into the fourth quarter. Can they hold on against the Seawolves? Three cool teams are sitting back, chilling right now, watching this one, saying fight it out. Stony Brook and North Carolina. Northwestern will take on the winner of this game. Boston College and Maryland looking forward to that semifinal number two next weekend.
This is such a battle, and it's so interesting, the journey of Stony Brook to get here through Rutgers. You know, these two teams, they met last year in the quarterfinal. They're very familiar with each other. Stony Brook has had an excellent season and the highest RPI that they've ever had, and I'm not so sure they got seated appropriately.
Big chip on their shoulder coming in, and Jamie Ortega has been held scoreless tonight. Twarton finalist. The defense is locked in for Joe Spallina. One more quarter left of lacrosse here tonight in Carolina as Andy Del Dave picking up the tying goal at 5-all.
This is huge. Stony Brook never made it to the Final Four. Carolina, arguably one of the best seasons that they had, undefeated. It's incredible. I mean, you can feel the tension in the air. Both of these two teams, they want to win. They deserve to win. They deserve to be in that Final Four, but just one can move ahead.
And it may all come down to the draw circle.
I'm not an official. They have a tough job. We don't make it easy with the rules being so subjective.
Very subjective.
But you know, we're lost for words. And that call.
Feeling the clunk.
Come on. No SAT words here.
Bastiani, you're back. Hillman. Met with a double team. They have had Three's number locked in off of the scout tonight, really have.
And credit to them, because not often Jamie Ortega goes scoreless. It just doesn't happen.
Mastriani is docked, and that ball bounces right into Campbell's hands.
Dillon, number 23 for Stony Brook, directing traffic. Great job, UNC. You see them all marked up in the middle of the field. They all have marks, making it very difficult for Stony Brook to transition this ball. That's huge.
It's taking a ton of time off of the shot clock right now.
And they're being very patient. Oftentimes in the ride, you see players jump to the ball and it gives the other team a quick breakaway, but super impressed with that ride. I think that's an area that UNC has really improved in this year.
Switch up by the Tar Heels. The shot clock closes into 10. Seawolves at heart trying to make some motion into the goal area.
I thought that was good defense by Gabby Hall, number 5 for Carolina. Let's see. The stick goes into the body. Okay. Horizontal. Extension of the arms. I can see where the officials might have seen that as a foul, but this is a big 8 meter for Stony Brook.
Ready to whip it from the left. All from behind. Goes low and wide. Big break. Huge break.
Emily Knowles, that's why you put your stick in the passing lane. Just like in basketball, hands up in the paint, sticks in the passing lane, because you just might get some sort of deflection. It doesn't have to be you taking the ball away from the other player on the 8 meter. Any little ricochet counts, and now they have a fast break transition, and this is where UNC, lethal.
Trenchard working it hard upfield. Fortunately, Jamie Ortega was there off of the errant ball. Aldave up over the top. Andy Aldave with two key goals here late. And now a two-goal cushion for Carolina.
And I'm impressed with her ability to rebound. You get two charges called against you, that can mess you up as a player. In your mind, it can do something with you. But she's been able to bounce back, reset that mentality. And two big goals here late in this game. You can't leave her open in the middle of the field. Great job by Jamie Ortega, threading the needle through traffic, through three Stony Brook players. And Annie Aldave having the poise and the calmness before the goal to get it around Charlie Campbell. Much needed. Second goal tonight, 49th goal this season. So impressive from the transfer from Notre Dame. She told us she loved her time at Notre Dame, and Chris Halfpenny speaks really highly of her, the head coach for Notre Dame, and she was a leader for Notre Dame.
Absolutely.
And it's been awesome to watch her transition into this squad for UNC and really come alive, and just, I've seen that leadership flourish.
Absolutely, getting it done in the classroom, how about that? Degree from Notre Dame, degree from Carolina. That's not a bad piece of paper to walk into any job that you're inquiring about. Three goals in the last 6 minutes for the Tar Heels. Aldave has two of those three.
And that's a great point that you brought up, Leah, because oftentimes we're so critical, we crush the stats.
Right.
But these student athletes, they're getting a degree, they're getting an education, and it's much bigger than just lacrosse. And it's impressive what they do on the lacrosse field, but they can get it done in the classroom, and they're such great examples for the little laxers, any young player out here who's watching tonight.
Ortega, she had a flash of a space, but waiting for some numbers to come in, help out on the attack.
And that's some maturity.
Yeah.
Younger player might have taken that opportunity, haven't scored a goal yet, but Jamie Ortega is very selfless, and that is a coach's dream. That's how you make your team better. She's waiting for numbers so they can attack when it's the appropriate time.
Scotty Rose took one on the hip off of the cross check there. Not in a fun spot.
There's a big emphasis this year, extension of the arms. You see the stick go horizontal. That's a foul. That is 100% a foul.
Scotty Rose taking a breath there. Second on a team with 53 goals coming in. Third in points for Tar Heels, which are both career highs for number 15 and one. Nice job of a breakup by the Seawolves.
Taylor Dillon.
Leaving with a little stutter step. Working hard, getting over the line as Coach Spallina somehow ran down the sidelines and managed to call a timeout.
In a suit. He's getting his steps in.
Trying to get those numbers in down the line, and Coach Spallina wants to take a timeout here, set up his tack. Welcome back to Chapel Hill, North Carolina. Out of the timeout, Seawolves trying to set up something on their attack. This is the third meeting between these two teams in their young series career. Carolina has won both of those meetings, and Stony Brook trying to make it to the semifinals for the first time.
Stony Brook and North Carolina, they played twice last year, and the first score, not so great. The second score, competitive, and that's what you're seeing here. Stony Brook, they're not afraid. They're not coming to Carolina to bow down to UNC. They're not afraid. They have that underdog mentality. They got a chip on their shoulder, and we've talked about it all game, rightfully so. I just don't think the selection committee rewarded them, not just for their RPI, but how they played at the end of the season. I think that really needs to be taken into account. And they've gone out and played some tough opponents, and they deserve to be recognized as a great in women's lacrosse. And I know that that's a big goal of Joe Spolino.
Key possession here as we close in on 10 minutes to go in this game. And a turnover. Huge opportunity. Mastriani in the open field, look out. And a nice closeout on Wurzburg.
Good decision. In that split second, Wurzburger had to make a decision. Do I feed it in? She could have. But what would that girl have done in the 8-meter if she received that ball? That's a great second decision to pull it out, work it around. Very impressed with her maturity as a young attacker.
Trying to flip it quickly to Aldave. Boy, that was a tight space. Hillman had a little bit more of an open shot.
And a great hustle play. Not the shot.
Not the shot. And square right into Charlie Campbell.
That's the angle. She's a lefty, Sam Dyer's. She can shoot from that right elbow, but you gotta move the levels of your stick a little bit. That's a shot that Charlie Campbell watched film on. She knows the tendencies of the UNC attack, but you do have to anticipate.
Dyer's back with 2 goals already on the night. Seawolves trying to break a 12-minute drought here. Cut this 1-1.
Love the goalie talk. You can hear Addex, Cutters, watch the Cutters from the top. They're setting up a play, Ellie Massera. She could feed or she could dodge. She's 1v1 right now with Brooklyn Walker Wells.
Working on B-Dub. And a collision around the 8 between Knowles and Massera.
Did you give her that nickname?
Yeah, B-Dub. B-Dub.
I like it.
Carolina trying to work quickly. Draw the shooting space violation.
That's the right decision. You see Scotty Rose Griner, she pumped. She knew that if she shot, dangerous shot. Would have been a yellow card. Great awareness by the attacker. She's good from this 8-meter. She's quick on her first step.
Scotty Rose on the top. Good stick check by the Seawolves.
You hear the chatter, the chirping to the officials. We've said it all game long, but the communication from the goalkeepers and the defense, it only works when you're communicating if you listen. Which I think as a defender, you have to listen.
Right.
You know, you can just talk to talk on defense, but if you're not listening to your teammates, you're not a cohesive unit.
Keep in mind, those defenders are running with players, running off the backside, coming off the blind side. Scotty Rose draws that shooting space violation. Again, nice job.
Same half. So they're in the same half.
Yes.
Tight.
She likes that left elbow. And oftentimes you would. She's a dominant righty. She can use both hands. She's elite. But she does have players on the right and left side of her. This time only a single on each side.
Square at Charlie Campbell.
They gotta shoot better. We heard coming out of the timeout, Emily Perra said, you need to put the ball in the back of the net. That is your job. Do your job. Charlie Campbell's a good goalie. You gotta move her off her line. You gotta change levels. She's tracking that ball out of Scotty Rose grabbing his stick.
And the defenses for both teams have been stellar. Neither team has had a lead larger than two tonight.
Defense by Emily Knowles. You can hear Taylor Moreno saying, step up. You don't want to wait until the attacker comes to you. You want to step into their space to throw them off their mark a little bit.
Play broken up. Flag was up. Oh, and a rebound. Third opportunity. My goodness.
That was insane.
What a flurry.
There's a player down in the middle of the 8-meter. Stony Brook, they're still shooting. I thought it should have been a foul. Number 20, Erin McCrory. She was legitimately on the ground, and the Brook players are shooting around her. Insanity. That was an insane possession.
That was insanity. Carolina wants a timeout to discuss it, to set up their attack on this play. Under 5 minutes to go in this game. And the defenses have been solid, rock solid. Goalkeepers for both teams have been rock solid tonight.
Such a fun game to watch. That last possession was something. A bit of loss of words for it, but watch this. Drives in, gets the stick check. She's on the ground, her goggles come off. Stony Brook says, that's fine, we're still gonna try and shoot and score on Taylor Moreno. Love that hustle play by Taylor Moreno.
It's disgusting.
In those opportunities, you can see the ball goes out.
It's unbelievable. You have the flag.
We got to listen to this.
The ball went over there. She was right in front of the goal. We deserve better. We deserve better. We deserve better.
Well, the NCAA coverage of women's lacrosse will continue next weekend for the semifinals. The action will begin on Friday night, the 27th. At 3 Eastern on ESPNU. For more information on the 2022 Women's Lacrosse Championship, what a season it has been, visit NCAA.com for all of your NCAA championships.
We're gonna need some plays. But I want to see any fucking fear in eyes right now. All right?
Heated words, Joe Spolina.
A solid 5 minutes to work with. Carolina has the ball. Stony Brook needs the ball.
Yes,
obviously
they need the ball.
You can't score, you know, you can't score. You don't have possession of the ball. What do Seawolves need to do on this attack to force that shot clock to not be wound down so deep by the Tar Heels on this series?
They gotta play clean defense. That's number one. Do not foul. Coach Bellina talking him up in that huddle. Don't let that emotional charge affect your play on the field. Let it inspire you, but don't do something that's gonna cause an issue. The game's winding down. 2-goal deficit, that's not a big deal,
no,
so to speak.
Absolutely not.
4:40 left in the fourth quarter, but you've gotta play lockdown defense. You gotta use that communication. And it's the 1v1, it's the fundamentals. Go back to your defensive fundamentals, your footwork, your vision, your communication. Team defense is huge.
Woo. shot off. Tar Heels keep possession. 18 on the shot clock. And it goes back to the Seawolves.
This is huge.
Plenty of time.
Love Scotty Rose Browning, the breakdown of the steps. The ride is so critical, especially in moments like this.
Tar Heels bringing it on, leaving looking for some help as Missouri and Park come back to the ball.
So impressed all game long. Stony Brook, offensively, their attackers, their midfielders, they're so poised when they cross that 30-yard line. Oftentimes, when you're playing a team like Carolina, they can rattle you defensively because they are so strong and they're so dominant, but I'm so impressed with the poise from Stony Brook and the willingness and the patience. They're attacking around that 30-second mark on the shot clock.
Caitlin Hart was in the traffic. Mastriani comes out of it. That could have been the difference right there off of that turnover.
I don't think that was a call either.
No.
Carolina had there was three white jerseys, and Stony Brook ran into that defensive pressure. But it's a big game, emotions are high. They needed a score in that possession like we talked about.
Her hands of Ortega, looks for Adale, shoots it wide.
That's a great feed.
Doesn't reset the shot clock. Quick movement, Adale with a hat trick.
Great goal by Andy Aldave. The first one didn't work on the feed from Jamie Ortega, but the second time, she just hangs out in the 8-meter. You gotta put a body on Andy Aldave. Great job, right in front of Charlie Campbell. It's difficult to score. She makes it look easy, but when you're up so close and so high with that goalkeeper, you really have to have that finesse in your shot. It doesn't have to be hard, and that's exactly what Andy Aldave does. She got a hat trick tonight.
50th of the season, back-to-back hatties for Andy Aldave. 5 of the 8 goals by the Tar Heels tonight. Completed by transfers.
I love it. I love to see it. I think that's what makes this Carolina team so deep and so strong is that
absolutely.
We always talk about Jamie Ortega, and rightfully so, because she's a star, but internally, that's not only the dialogue at UNC. It's next woman up, and you see Andy Aldave, Sam Dyer's back getting it on the scoreboard. There's a selflessness to the offense.
Aldave's dream coming true. One of the reasons why she wanted to come to Carolina, have the opportunity to play for a national championship. She and her teammates are 151 away from being just one step closer to that opportunity. On that draw, the biggest draw. Getting it in sure hands here for Carolina as the Seawolves need a turnover. Get some high ball pressure on. They should be applauded. Everything they had in the kitchen sink.
Absolutely. So much heart, hustle on the field. They gave North Carolina a heck of a game. Best quarterfinal game. Closest.
Absolutely.
I didn't necessarily think it was going to be this close. I knew it was going to be a battle. You and I talked about it, especially in the first half. But credit goes to Stony Brook. They are making their name known. They deserve to be in this national conversation. Such ballers out there. Backyard ballers. Gritty, tough. They don't care how it gets done, but it's getting done.
First yellow card of the night. And that will go on Stony Brook, unfortunately. Ella Whitehouse picking up the card.
You can see her. She's upset on the sideline. Rightfully so. But maybe an emotional foul there towards the end of the game. I understand. It happens.
Seawolves will finish the year 16-3. They will move on to the CAA next season. Great fight. Carolina will improve to 20-0 and continue the run, winning 55 of their last 57 games.
Incredible. This was a hard-fought battle. North Carolina came out on top, but Stony Brook, they didn't make it easy. They did not make it easy. I know that Jenny Levy and her staff are going to go back to the drawing board, reevaluate, watch film on this, but congratulations to the Tar Heels, and really congratulations to Stony Brook. Heck of a season for them, too.
Andy Aldame with the hat trick. She and the Tar Heels try to make a run at a third national championship. The 10th semifinal trip now in 13 years, 12 total to the semis.
And they're gonna face Northwestern, who put a beating down on Syracuse. So tall task ahead, but congratulations to the Tar Heels. You see the staff. They want to get back to this national championship. They've got a lot of pain from last year. Going undefeated, they've been in a very similar situation, but this year just feels a little bit different. The fight, the tenacity from them, punching back when Stony Brook punched at them. Overall, just physical game.
Seawolves took a 1-0 lead. North Carolina responded. They had to fight through the turnovers tonight in the stingy defense. For the Seawolves, four unanswered goals late in the game, the difference. So a rematch from a game earlier this season that you and I did between Northwestern and Carolina. That early season matchup, Carolina winning it 20-9. We'll see what happens this second time around with so much on the line. And the bottom side of your bracket, Boston College will take on Maryland.
We are ready for the Final Four. I do think the North Carolina-Northwestern matchup, it's going to be a little different.
Absolutely.
Northwestern, they're trending in the upward direction at the right time. They're peaking when they need to. But Boston College, Maryland, that's a good old-fashioned matchup right there. Kathy Reese, Acacia Walker, they've got some familiarity with each other.
Both teams getting set for a handshake on the sidelines, which is great to see. We're back doing that again in the show of sportsmanship, this great game of lacrosse. Some of these players know each other from travel ball, from youth ball, from Team USA. Great respect between the two squads.
Lacrosse is a very small world, and it gets smaller the farther you get out, but there's a familiarity between Jenny Levy and Joe Spolina. A lot of these players, like you said, US, they play Athletes Unlimited. Sydney Pareka on staff for the Seawolves, Allie Kennedy, familiar names that you hear, Emily Perros, Kaylee Waters. I mean, the list of talent goes on and on, just on the field, but also on the coaching staff. And tonight was a great display and a message for women's lacrosse that the game is here to stay, and this is the competitive fire that we wanted in a quarterfinal game, and we got it. And two really good teams, you got to tip your hat to Stony Brook. You know, they have a lot to be proud of after the season that they had.
Absolutely. Nine seniors graduate for Stony Brook. And we wish them certainly well as they head off into that next career path. Certainly been set up solid fashion with the great balance of athletics and academics through the difficult time of COVID. Seawolves will come over to the sidelines here, meet up with their fans.
Lots of emotions for the Seawolves squad. You saw them walking off the field, tears in their eyes. It's sad when the season ends. You know, you put a lot into this. It's a long season, and they've done an incredible job. Just a great display for women's lacrosse the whole day, all four quarterfinal matchups.
And the Tar Heels will do the same now. Heading over to their side. Great crowd on hand tonight to watch this women's lacrosse matchup. And really just a packed house on a Thursday night in Chapel Hill. Joining us now, the fifth year goalkeeper for North Carolina. Sixth year. You're coming back maybe again for another year when we can figure this out. Taylor Marino, great job in goal.
Thank you.
What a start. Tell us what you were thinking. We knew that Stony Brook was going to come out guns a-blazing.
Yeah, no, they're a really hard, gritty team. And we obviously knew they were going to throw everything at us, so it was just going to be see who can hold out the longest.
You're such a stud in cage. You told us earlier that each win on Durant's field gets special every time. What is this win? This is your last win on this field. What does it mean to you tonight?
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of surreal to think that I'm never going to come back and play a game here again. Honestly, it's just been, I'm just super grateful to have even had the opportunity to play here in such a great facility. And honestly, it's just been a blessing to be here for 6 years. I don't think I would have come back if I didn't love it here, if I didn't love this team, if I didn't love my coaches, and obviously just the entire environment around us. So I'm just super grateful.
Taylor, you get the opportunity here to go against the team you're familiar with, Northwestern, a little bit earlier this season. What do you think about that matchup in the semifinals?
Yeah, they're an awesome team. Big offensive powerhouse. Lauren Gilbert's just absolutely unreal. So we're going to have our work cut out for us, and it's going to be a long week of prep for sure.
Taylor, it's been a pleasure watching you grow into the young woman you have.
I appreciate that.
Appreciate your time as always. Congratulations. Go enjoy this one with the team.
Thank you very much, guys.
Taylor Marino, the Tar Heels, 8-5, the victors. Come on back on the flip side. We'll wrap this one up from Chapel Hill. Welcome back to Chapel Hill, North Carolina. Tar Heels advance to the national semifinals, holding on to defeat Stony Brook 8-5. Taylor Marino was solid in goal with a defense behind her. 10 saves on the night.
Such a stud, and we've watched her all year long, all career long. She just does so much for this North Carolina defense. She's so athletic. She's a black belt in jiu-jitsu. We didn't even mention that during the broadcast. She's so athletic. She has those double saves, back-to-back saves. She just reads the defense so well, and she's a force there in cage.
Capital One, player of the game. What was in her pocket? Oh, 10 saves tonight.
Saves.
Great effort by Taylor Marino and her Tar Heel defense in front of her. As we take a look at the bracket, now set up for the national semifinals. Carolina, Northwestern, Boston College, Maryland. Dana, what do you like about the final four teams?
First of all, we are in for a treat. The lacrosse gods have treated us with some of the best teams in the country. I'm really excited to see the Boston College Maryland rematch. Boston College, they want to get back to that championship game, but they got to go through Maryland, who I thought put on an impressive performance against Florida. They've got to stop not just Aurora Accordingly, but Libby May, Abby Bosco. It's a well-rounded team. You look at all four of these teams, they're all well-rounded. It's not just one player for each team, and I think that's going to make it really exciting.
10 hours of women's lacrosse coverage today on ESPN. So glad you could join us. Great for the lacrosse community. Sticks are up in solidarity for Delaware State and Howard as well. The final 8-5. Carolina moves on. They will take on Northwestern. For our entire crew, my colleague Dana Boyle, it sure has been fun. 8-5, Carolina. So long from Chapel Hill.